Okay. So thanks for the introduction. So I'm Prem and this is Prakash. Today we are going to do a repeat presentation of what we did in Open Networking Summit early this month. The whole edge cloud is gaining a lot of traction, and 5G being the main enabler. What is important here is one is the infrastructure part. When we talk about the infrastructure, the whole edge cloud infrastructure, and then the other radio infrastructure that enables the whole edge cloud. But also on the other side, you do need to look at how you design the apps. For example, if you look at the edge cloud as such, you have AR, VR, the drones, then you have industrial IoT, so on and so forth, that are the main prime driving factor for the 5G to gain traction, right? So in this session, what we are trying to do is we are trying to capture, as an application developer, what are the important aspects you need to take care in order to design your apps so that you can exploit the benefits of 5G. It's a two-part session. The first part, I would probably touch upon the microservices patterns. And then the second part, Prakash is going to cover more in terms of the stateless as well as how to maintain state with respect to the application. So as you see, there are a couple of things. One is the application requirements. If you look at the application types to begin with, the application can be categorized into two types. One is the offline application, another one is the online application. What is meant by offline application here is, for example, take a cell phone. You do have a VR, AR apps, or you have gaming application. So if you look at it, if your cell phone or if your devices are quite powerful enough, they can host or they can execute the application in the same environment. But let's assume that certain VR, for example, they have to have a lot of rendering as well as compute power. It may not be available in the device. So what happens is you have the front end sitting on the devices, which is a mobile phone, and the back end sits on the cloud, right? So these are the two categories, broad categories, where we can categorize this application, the mobile applications. And also, if you look at the offline applications, it's mostly the fat client. It basically does a lot of processing within the same device. And you continuously get the data feed from the cloud. For example, take your famous game, Pokemon Go. The Pokemon Go is an AR, VR, it would be mostly an AR game, right? So here what happens is, if you look at it, if you don't have an internet, it would not work. The reason is it tries to push and pull the data from that of the servers, the Pokemon Go servers that are usually hosted on Google Cloud, and that's how things work, right? Whereas if you look at the online applications where you just have the presentation layer, right? And then all processing is done online, when I say online, in the cloud, and then it requires connectivity, right? One other important thing here is also the key requirements. What are the key requirements? The key requirements being my bandwidth requirement, right? Then the latency, the jitter, and delay related to that of the application, how it can handle, and also the location and presence. All of it goes back to the central cloud and comes back, which means if you are talking about real-time applications or mission-critical applications, you cannot afford to have the jitter associated with the application be supported in the current model. That is where the whole concept of edge cloud comes into picture, right? So in case of edge cloud, I mean, I don't want to again get into the edge cloud, but what I want to briefly touch upon is edge cloud is nothing but you have the core cloud as well as the edge cloud. The edge cloud does not have all of it, but it tries to host some compute that would essentially satisfy certain needs. For example, the need might be a response within a few milliseconds, right? So the edge immediately transforms, or it may even basically end your session and then continue to do some offline processing and then get back to the result, right? So that's what these architectures are pretty much driven by HC. HC came out with what we call as the, it started as mobile edge cloud, but it became a multi-access edge cloud, right? The current version, what we are talking about, is called the multi-access edge cloud. And this particular slide is essentially the current architecture that is defined by HC standards. Couple of things which we need to look at here is the UE app, of course, it sits right there. And then if you look at, there is a
User app LCM proxy. What is an LCM? It's lifecycle management, right? So there is a proxy that sits that manages the version of the UE app. And then here is what is an important part of it, right? You do have the complete OSS as well as the edge orchestration system that plays a very, very important role in orchestrating the whole of it. What is meant by that is, for example, in the conventional world, the OSS BSS, the telco OSS BSS pretty much takes care of infrastructure orchestration, right? For example, ensuring that the connectivity is there, ensuring the application related to that of the telco infrastructure is up and running. In case it is not, how do we do balance of the equipment, so on and so forth. But in case of the mobile edge cloud, the orchestration plays a very, very important role. In fact, I'm going to the next slide to get more details about it. Before that, let me also stress upon certain thing here. If you look at it, you can clearly see that there is a mobile edge system level, right, which is the topmost part of it, and then the other one is the mobile edge host level, right? So the system level pretty much handles the application specific as well as the function specific. With respect to the edge host level, you do have the complete mobile edge host, the related components, and also similar to that of the VNF concept, you do have VNF getting extended all the way up to that of the edge. Here is an important thing. So if you take telco VNF, the telco VNF can categorize depending upon what functions that particular telco plays. For example, if it's a central office, there are a bunch of virtual network functions. If there is a core, there are a bunch of virtual network functions. But here, what we need to look at is, we need to look at the VNF works closely with that of application-specific component. What is meant by that is, even though I mentioned categories of UE app as online, offline, the characteristics of this application also differs. For example, VR or AR, the hardware requirement as well as the network requirement differs, right? Medical equipment related app, the requirement differs. In that case, the VNF has to be aware about what is the requirement from the application and then instantiate or manage the edge based on that particular application. You see what I'm saying? So that's the difference between a typical general purpose VNF and the VNF when we talk about the mobile edge. So this is actually one of the things I think would be important for you from an information point of view is ONAP, right? ONAP, there is a new edge group that is formed. The intent of the edge group is essentially twofold. One is, in order to define what are the requirements ONAP has to get in terms of edge cloud, and also touch upon other areas, for example, use case definition, putting requirements on the application, so on and so forth. So it's a very, very interesting and important group that you can follow. In fact, we have a weekly call every Monday. The group is just beginning or having their initial specs defined. It's a good one to have more knowledge about this. Now, the earlier slide is about the architecture. This specific slide is about the internal working of how things work. If you look at this particular diagram, you do have on the device edge, you have the network edge, then you have the edge cloud, as well as you have the core cloud. Core cloud is our regular cloud, right? In the earlier diagram, I was mentioning about the orchestrator. So if you look at this diagram, ONAP, which is going to be the orchestrator, plays a couple of important roles. And also, there is a component called application function that essentially puts in or defines the requirement for that particular application, or it defines what is the application requirements, and then ensures whether my mobile edge meets that requirement or not, right? Most of you are familiar with how a mobility works, how the cell phone works, right? So at any point of time, the cell phone would connect to a particular radio base station, right? When it connects to the radio base station, it also knows in case if that particular connection goes off, what would be my secondary or where should I switch on, move on, right? So that is just with respect to ensuring that you have the voice as well as the data these days available, right? But here, what we are talking about is an application wherein the application component also has to move from one edge cloud to another edge cloud. You see what I'm saying? Since these edge clouds are pretty much close to the radio base station, there might be a possibility where a mobility of the whole infrastructure gets into play, right? So that's a bit of, I would say, a bit of a drastic change in the whole deployment model. So in that case, you do need these functions in order to ensure that the infrastructure meets those requirements, right? So let's take an example. So you have three types of applications, one with green, blue, and another one is a gray. So they are represented by application function one, application function two, application function three. What does these application functions do? The application functions are representative, or they know what this particular UE app requires, right? So in this case, say for example, the UE app one is corresponding AF1. It basically, what it does is, now it needs to deploy the component that are needed for the UE app on this edge cloud. In that case, what it does is, the UE app requests the AF, which is the application function, to create compute for it. It may not be compute, it can also be any other thing. For simplicity sake, let's say it's compute, right? So the compute here may differ depending upon what I was explaining. It might be AR, VR, it might be a gaming offload, right? Now the UE also provides information, I mean it might differ. It may provide what is my coordinate, what is my max cost, what is my max latency, so on and so forth. And the moment you have this, here the orchestrator kicks in. What happens is the AF, which is the application function, requests ONAP to create the VNF in the edge, right? Now, it, ONAP knows, okay, this is my edge cloud. Edge cloud 1, edge cloud 2, edge cloud 3, this is the requirements, this is their characteristic, and it can pick from there. It's more like resource management. It can pick from there, which is the closest edge cloud that can satisfy my requirement. Once it's picked, it deploys or it creates the VNF. As I said, here VNF means the app representation or the app proxy or the app itself sitting along with the VNF, where the VNF does specific functions similar to specific to the app, right? So the basically what happens is the ONAP picks up which is the edge cloud, and then it figures out what are the characteristics of it, configures it, and then brings in the VNF, right? So if you look at the first one is the request, second one is essentially the ONAP request to the ONAP, the third one is essentially the ONAP brings up the VNF, and then what happens is the moment everything is done, now the application function informs the SMF to create traffic rules, because traffic rule has to be reconfigured so that the traffic gets routed to this particular edge. And then all of this control functions are done, and then now the UE app gets connected to that of this particular edge cloud, right? So as you see, there is a lot of moving pieces in this whole puzzle, right? The preparation, ensuring that the state management is done, so on and so forth. So the next few slides, what we are going to talk about is, we are going to talk about how can you simplify or how can you make the whole play a simpler one, right? So in order to
give some life, what we thought was, we'll explain you with a sample application, right? So what we did was we took a simple application of a pothole fixer, right? What this particular app does is, assume there is a bobcat which has capability of going to a particular place and then filling up the potholes, right? So here what happens is, there is a dashboard app that sits along with or in the bobcat. The bobcat can be autonomous or it can be human driven. Then there is a dispatcher app that sits or dispatches the jobs to that equipment. And then there is a pothole fix app, the app that is in core cloud, which has information about the pothole, right? Imagine a city like San Jose, right? There are so many roads, and then the pothole has to work, and the pothole cannot, fixer cannot work in tandem during that high traffic hours. So you need to do a lot of logistics as well as analysis before you can deploy this, right? So just to explain it in terms of the function, so the system function would essentially be, okay, since you have seen that there are three parts to it, let me reiterate again. The dashboard app sits on the Bobcat, the dispatcher app sits on the edge cloud, and then the pothole fix app sits on the core cloud, right? So you can see that the dashboard app as well as the dispatcher app are in a way similar application, or they need to work together, right? So if I have to replay this, what happens is the AF request comes from that of the dashboard app, right? Meaning the dashboard app connects with that of the radio base station, and then ONAP knows, or any orchestrator knows, that there has to be something done for this. The Vim, and it basically triggers the VNF. This is the system function, right? So this is typically we saw how things work here, right? Whereas in the application function, what is needed is, it's a bit of real time, wherein it would need to know where the pothole is, which means it gets a pothole image, it goes to the particular location, and then what happens is, it cannot just go ahead and then fix the pothole, right? It has to basically look at the current budget, can I have all the resources needed for it, and then fix it. So in that case, the dashboard app, it connects with that of the edge app, and then it continuously gets the data and then proceeds based on this, right? Actually, I want to explain more on about this, but I believe we are stressed out for time. Let me move on with the core part of it. How many of you don't know microservices? Okay. So I see people who don't know microservices to be less, so I'll probably give a half a minute explanation about microservices and then move on to details about it. So typically microservices are nothing but you take an application, identify what are the smaller components that can be independent, and then these smaller components can be deployed as you wish, right? I don't know whether you're familiar with Google phone that was announced, but I didn't come to market, but it's similar to that of it. What Google did was, they said, why the phone should be monolithic? I will give you bricks, right? A brick for your camera, a brick for your other functions. What you can do is you can assemble, you can pick and choose what camera you want and then assemble your own phone. So you can loosely say that the microservice architecture is nothing but dividing a bigger component to smaller functions and then customize it as you want. But I've just kept it simple, but we can probably connect offline to discuss more about it. Now, for a microservice architecture to be realized, there are a few building blocks. The building blocks, I call it as microservices patterns, right? So these are those patterns. How many of you are familiar with this? Okay, so I can explain you in detail. So since most of you know microservices, the most important thing is you would need to know first and foremost on how you decompose, right? Given a monolithic application, you should know how to decompose. One is decomposition. The moment you decompose, you need to know how the various components talk with each other, which means the communication style kicks in. In a microservice architecture, another important thing, since the whole application software is divided, or any software is divided into smaller components, you also need to know how do I handle the data part. When I talk about data part, how do I handle a database transaction, right? So you do have lots of questions, right? So there has to be some guiding principle to help you do things simple in a simple way, and that is where the microservice patterns comes in, right? So this is a reference. This is a very good website if you want to go and learn more about it. Chris Richardson, he is in fact based on Oakland. He is in fact was the initial founders of Cloud Foundry. So he has documented a lot about microservices. And this particular thing is one image that captures all of the design patterns, right? So the design patterns are essentially categorized into infrastructure patterns, application infrastructure patterns, and then application patterns. The infrastructure patterns talks about the deployment. It talks about how do I discover the services as well as the communication. The application infrastructure pattern talks about how is the infrastructure work. When I say infrastructure, what is the communication style? How is the security handled? What are the metrics, measures, as well as analysis that can be done, which we call as observability. Then also, when we move to application patterns, you have the decomposition, which I was talking about. Then the query, how do you handle the query, meaning database query. Then how do we maintain the data consistency, so on and so forth. But for our discussion, I have picked only few patterns. The patterns essentially are, for example, in the edge scenario, the recommendation would be ensure that you deploy your apps or the service in container, right? That's the recommendation one, right? The reason I'll talk about later. Then with respect to the communication style, you can probably use messaging because you need to have this coupling a bit looser as against having a tight coupling, right? Then when we talk about data consistency, there is a pattern called Saga pattern that talks about how to ensure transactions are done, but when the transactions are distributed, how do we ensure that you have those consistency maintained? So that's about Saga patterns. I'll get into details about it in the next slide. Another important thing also I didn't mark it is also there is something called as distributed tracing. A distributed tracing is a framework. The standards for that would be called as the Open Tracing, which is a CNCF project. The Open Tracing essentially helps you to trace a single call all the way up to its complete life cycle of the call. And using that particular Open Tracing, what you can do is you can see what are the bottlenecks that is causing delay in your call to be executed. I strongly feel that you do need to have this infrastructure because in an edge cloud scenario, you would essentially need to ensure where are the bottlenecks and then address it. So the reason why we are suggesting that the application developer use these patterns is because you see that there has to be mobility happening, right? As I was mentioning, the VNF has to move from one edge cloud to another edge cloud. How do I do? Can I do a VM migration? May not be possible because typically when you do a live VM migration, there is a bit of requirement that is put on the network. Only if the requirement is met, then only the VM gets migrated. Whereas in case of containers, the whole microservices goes with the fact that the state of the particular application is in a way decoupled from that of the application so that you can essentially put down or pull down a container somewhere and then bring it up somewhere. For example, Kubernetes, the whole concept of pod, the assumption is it is by default ephemeral in nature. When I say ephemeral, if you say I need a 10 pod, the 10 pod gets created. If one of the pod gets killed, Kubernetes doesn't worry. It creates one other pod and then it keeps running, right? So here, by design, what happens is the data is in a way separated from that of the application. So these are the benefits where if you develop the application based on Microsoft's architecture, you also help in faster mobility and also data consistency. With that, I'll move on to the Saga patterns. This is a very, very important pattern. It basically replaces a two-phase commit. What it does is, let's assume that application, there are three components or four components that are participating in the transaction, right? What it does is, it's more like everyone executes and then says, I have executed successfully. Once all of the components mentions that it is successful, then only the transaction is set as executed, right? There are two ways to do it. One is via choreography and another one is via orchestration. I don't want to get into details, but this is just for your information. So with that, I'll probably hand over the mic to Prakash. He's going to get into the details about cloudlet, statelet, the talks about state management and other information. Yeah, thanks.
Prem really left at a very good point where he brought to the idea of microservices. Microservices is not container, but microservices can be put in containers or can be put in container, could be in VM. So they are not synonymous, that be clear on that. Microservices is simply set of APIs that we can represent a particular function, disaggregated function. So it should be unique function and does only one thing, but does it well. Having said that, MEC architecture, which you saw with all the host management, the system management, host platform management, and platform managing the application, and then underneath the network, all this with MM1, MM9, and then MMP1, 2, 3, and so on and so forth. All these interfaces, each one have some API. So if I am given a blind check, do implement MEC as microservices. First thing I'll do is, okay, what are the interfaces? What are the APIs? Okay, here are 11. Blindly, I can say that I need 11 microservices minimum if the functions are really distinct. Okay, now there are some interwoven functions you have to isolate, but you can see that a simple implementation requires 11. It is not simple, I'm sorry, but each one of them will lead to many more. So 100 microservices is a very, very normal thing, so it's not out of way. So the complexity increases as you increase more and more decomposition, because you need to recompose them to be able to use any functions on top of it, and the application being the function here. Like in the case of pothole fixing, we said dispatcher is at the edge and the UE or the tablet or whatever is tied to that Bobcat moving around, or ready-made concrete mixer, whatever you call RCC or something like that with a truck and all. Those two have different functionality. And then that, if I take a UE and if I am supposed to connect to a carrier called AT&T or Verizon, how does it get connected? You need to configure. So basically your authentication comes from the host, which is in the whatever LAN you call IMS or GILAN or wherever it be. So the HLR, HSS, whatever the entry is there. So you have to configure that. And that configuration gets deployed, because when you go to your retail shop and take a UE, they will say, hey, I will configure it for you. What do? They connect to your local base station and say, hey, this is your home location. Here is your configuration. I slap on it and then that's configured and that's what you use. So essentially you are tied to a central cloud, not necessarily, which is in the IMS, not at the edge. Then the edge comes, so the dispatch application. So there is something called front hall, back hall. You have a first the access, then the core, and in access also you are all over the places distributed. So the essential is the concept does exist. Edge didn't happen overnight. It is there, but the only thing is, should we serve from the centralized location, or should we serve from local? And so mid-hall you can call it, but I don't want to complicate more terminology. It's somewhere in the base station. Okay, so you have radio remote radio head, RU and BUs, what you call, or correspondingly 5G, whatever you call, DU and CUs, distributed unit and the central unit. So whatever the units are, essentially it's a distribution of nodes for serving an application. So in that sense, if I build the whole thing, this is like trying to do overkill. That's why if you ask anybody, it sucks because it's so complex, you can't. So what the MEC has done is, they have simplified by saying, okay, if your mind cannot handle this complexity, think of it as a VNF. So you have a VNF for the MIC platform. You have a VNF for MIC host. You got a VM for application or a VNF or even a container. So simplifying it, the complexity has to be hidden, otherwise it's overkill, and that's one of the problems MIC is facing. It's not that everything is perfect in life. You do have complexities, so we have to abstract, same way we need to abstract the application. The realization of MIC has been difficult for one of the reasons is that application people think that I run the show, value is here. And so I don't need network. I will put it on some cloud and it will automatically do everything. Doesn't happen that way. To larger extent, to certain extent for smaller application, fine. But when you have to integrate over the entire global network, which is network of networks like internet and as well as the carrier network, it gets into complexity of security, availability, and so many FCAPs, what you call. So essentially, this is where the limitation is. So the way to say that, hey, I don't need MIC, why do I need MIC? My application is stateless, I don't care. Well, possible, you can disconnect, you can connect, you can have nomadic, you can have you can have mobility, you can have everything, but it doesn't matter to you because you are stateless. But once you say you need state management, then you get stuck. And network providers, unless they have a stickiness, they are not going to do your work because they need something to provide the revenue value add for them. So essentially, this is a battle drawn between the vendors, the carriers, the cloud providers, and the win-win situation will come only when both have something common whereby they can build their own value add services. So this is the crux of this. So I'll move forward, get back to, Prem has explained you, but still I'll just put it this way. The MIC, before MIC was MIC, Professor Satya from CMU started his Cloudlet, and Cloudlet is well known to everybody. There are many open edge computing, and then there are Live Edge Lab and all. I highly recommend, if you need to understand, Cloudlet is a VM at the edge. Put it that way. So if you get a VM, you can do anything, and you install a OpenStack as your control instance or a Vim instance which controls the VM. Now, because that is partitioned in the MIC architecture all over places, it looks simple, but then for the state management, they run into issues. They maintain the state on the client side, which is at the device side, and therefore it's able to get over without, for developers, this is good. Cloudlet. But once you develop, when you want to host it and you want to ensure that it is available worldwide in the service provider network, then the migration is a big pain. And that's where the couple of years it has been stagnated. To overcome that, now we have the MEP. If you look at Mobile Edge platform is the one which supports the services for DNS, for traffic control. So these are some of the things, throughput, all this latency, all this can be managed through the platform services in conjunction with the central cloud, which in this case happened to be HSS and this IMS kind of thing. So application, this is a three-way, edge, central, device. Now how you coordinate between them, I will run through quick one example which shows you how do you manage persistent volume. For state management, because from all this what I have understood after some thought process, and of course I have been working with Prem for quite some time now, trying to figure out where should we, can I go and build 12 microservices and then say, oh, those 12 again spawns another 100, 120 I will do. It's impractical for an individual to embark on it. So what is the main pain point that is hurting this? State management. Application state management is the key. Of course, you say, oh, I can do distributed cache, I can do this, but essentially there has to be API to manage it universally all across platform, whether it's a ONAP, as Intel helped us in build that. And then we have OPNFE, they have their own way, and the OpenStack has its own way. So everybody has their own way in open, and every vendor has their own way in their private. So where do we go? So essentially what we figured out for state management is, if you are able to instantiate a application instance per user, per application. Having said that, it needs to manage its states on the server side of it. And the server being, in this case, host. So what we do is we ensure that by attaching a, instead of a thermal, as he said, you lose. If you disconnect, you lose. No way of recovery. Instead of that, put a VM or put a container. It could be a container or it could be host. So from the looking at it, you can see that a admin creates a persistent volume and creates a pool of it and say, hey, this is available to any application. Application goes and picks up, hey, I want to request a persistent volume to be attached to my instance, which is here, attach it, and all the metadata associated with it for that application. Maybe we can do a unique one specific to application, or you can do it generic if you have the application management capability in the platform. Either way, you can get that, and metadata could be application based, so we can attach and detach. So the only thing in this is, I have just drawn a little bit more extension beyond that. Not only you grant, you create a VM or a, attach a volume to it, or you create a, you already have a host and you just attach a container with the whatever pod to the pod, and then you claim, use it, and then once you have moved, if the application has to be moved based on the requirement from one edge to another edge, the attached gets detached, next another instance pops up there, or request is ordered through the orchestrator to make that happen, and you attach that state, and then state preserves. So state is preserved. The only thing is you have to instantiate. So computes, as long as computes can handle that, you can manage the application migration in a smooth way without getting into all the details of networking, because that has to be the key. Because once you do at MAC level, then you are in, oh, MAC address changes, what do I do? IP changes, how do I do? So to avoid all that, as long as you know what state is and you can replace that state and able to overcome that, it's a simpler thing. So that's all I have in this. Just to give you, this is all I am collaborating. Again, of course, there are, you can describe about the various classes. All of this is available. Nothing is new. It's only application of what is existing in Kubernetes, and how do we write the API and system level, admin level API to create pools and to allow attachments to be made and detachments to be made. And then finally, it can be applied to Kubernetes as well as to any of the VMs. And the final one is the user having those objects to use it based on the capacity need and how they list it, how they discover. So there are many processes involved. I wouldn't go into detail at this time. At this time, I would like to just show you the references. There is enough references here. Starting from bottom to top, bottom is being the microservices which Prem has provided to you, and you have got ONAP, OPNFE, and then OpenStack, all COLA for image creation, because image creation, ID management, these are important LDAP access. I think I should end here. We have next speaker here, and thank you very much for all your patience, and look forward to working with you in the future.